Good evening and welcome everyone. My name is Winifred Sullivan. I'm the chair of the Department of Religious Studies at IU. And today's lecture is the fourth in the department's fall lecture series. The fifth and final lecture will be in this room on Friday at 2 p.m. Michelle Molina of Northwestern University will be giving a lecture entitled, I Love the Jesuits, Reason and Affect in an 18th Century Conversion Narrative. So now for something completely different. I'm really pleased today to introduce my friend and colleague, Alessandro Ferrari, professor of law at the University of Insubria in Como, Italy. We have worked together on several projects to study the comparative politics of religion and religious freedom. Professor Ferrari is a specialist in the study of the modern regulation of religion in Europe. And increasingly, as we heard yesterday at his lecture in the law school, of the Mediterranean, seeing widening the scope of the lens and seeing the religious and legal landscape beyond the continent of Western Europe. In any event, he has many interests and many talents. I've learned a lot from him, and you will too. So I did want to announce first that Professor Ferrari's visit to IU this week is jointly sponsored by the Department of Religious Studies, the Law School, and the Islamic Studies Program. And I just learned from Dan Conkle, professor in the Law School, that Hoagy Carmichael is a graduate of the Law School. I don't know how many of you knew that. So not just a talented musician, but also a lawyer. So, Alessandro. Thank you.
Thank you. Good evening. So the talk of this evening will be a little different, hopefully, than the talk of yesterday, because now we're moving from a joint perspective. So yesterday we have talked about the relations between the two Mediterranean shores. Today we will be more concentrated on Europe, and so how the presence of Muslims in Europe, a huge presence of Muslims in Europe, is affecting societal relationships and also institutions in this continent. So in tonight's talk, I would like to accomplish four interrelated tasks. First, to situate the debate about Europe and Islam in a wider framework in order to avoid dangerous essentialisms. Second, to read the Islamic presence in Europe in the light of the transformations of European nation-states, stressed as they are between universalistic pretensions and retreats to particularistic local identities. Third, to show how the Muslim presence in Europe challenges the universalist and human rights-oriented European narrative, revealing ambiguities and contradictions in the institutional management of cultural and religious diversities. And finally, to point out that these tensions between universalism and particularism are shared by all societal actors, Muslims included. So first of all, the wider framework. Europe and Islam, or better, Europeans and Muslims, are an inextricable complex reality. They face common challenges. Secondly, European and Muslims are not simply facing issues about the accommodation of a specific new set of religious needs. Rather, they are confronted with the literally fundamental issue of the crisis or transformation of the supremacy of nation states vis-à-vis other social actors, religious communities included. Consequently, the presence of Islam is diagnostic of deeper European social changes. Nevertheless, in secular Europe, in the continent where secularity and secularism have even been defined as a global exception, an essentialized religious perspective has become the main, if not the only, optic through which millions of people are viewed. In fact, European societies and legal systems push and pressure individuals who might be described as religiously called in their countries of origin to invent a hot religious identity, both as a key to being integrated with their co-immigrants and also as an armor to stand with some dignity, although often a denied dignity, in the face of hostile European institutions and civil societies. On a predominantly Christian continent, a plural Muslim community is being forced to invent a single church, producing frustration and vicious circle. In other words, the right to religious freedom has become a problem rather than an instrument to solve problems. Setting aside the old Islamic presence in Europe, the golden age of Andalusia or Muslim Sicily, or more recently the Islam of the Balkans, Muslims arrived in Western Europe, most recently, as part of the post-colonial process, which coincided with the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, and for Europe in particular, a new constitutional time after the experience of the Second World War and the Shoah. This new constitutionalism was crucial for many reasons. First of all, it translated the universalistic discourse of human rights into national frameworks, opening very different national societal systems, both to internal pluralism and to a wider cooperation with other national systems, ending with the establishment of European Union. Second, within this new framework, the traditional national church-state systems experienced important changes. In fact, political constructs that had previously been hostile to religion, the secularism principle, for example, or that was against non-traditional national religions, as in the case of the principle of the state church, began to be interpreted in a more religion-friendly and pluralist way. These changes represented an opportunity for traditional European religions, in particular for Orthodox and Catholics, to start conciliating with human rights and with self-sufficient secular forms of secular power. On one hand, traditional religions accepted to be only a part of the nation. On the other, they could play an important role in the public sphere. National traditional churches were placed in a situation in some way similar to that of the nation states. Both national churches and national states, in fact, accepted to play in a more universalistic framework, following the changes of their theologies. Constitutional reforms for the state, adhesion to the notion of religious freedom based on free internal will for the churches. As a result, also in countries like Italy, Spain, and Ireland, religious affiliations eventually came to be understood as private, optional choices. In 1867, UK Labour Minister Roy Jenkins gave a definition of integration that well summarized this optimistic season of cool European multiculturalism. Integration was defined, he said, end quote, not as a flattening process of assimilation, but as an equal opportunity coupled with cultural diversity in an atmosphere of mutual tolerance. End of the quotation. This definition testified a potential general opening to different cultural practices, but also, on the other, the tendency made possible by secularization to include religion within the broader category of culture and not to grant it any specific role in shaping individual and collective identities. In other words, the religious question was perceived as closed. Muslims began to arrive in the middle of these deep European changes. They were very welcomed by a continent in desperate need of manpower. Moreover, the immigrants were not seen as Muslims. Islam didn't exist at that time. Immigrants were conceived as workers, certainly with some folk traditions, but absolutely without pervasive religious claims. Wearing a headscarf, asking for halal food, getting married predominantly within one's own community, keeping apart from mainstream views and behaviors, were not received with anxiety by autochthonous Europeans or by Muslims, but as normal things dependent on many factors that legitimately could affect daily life. Secularization, the fact that most Muslims tried to simply reproduce their customs within giving them a particular theological meaning, and the possibility that many of them would return home after earning some money in the West, contributed to this apparently calm situation. But the tolerant and religion-blind time didn't last. The Europeanization of national legal systems and the opening to new values by traditional churches started arising some imbalances. First of all, Europeanization involved not only the economic sphere, but inevitably also political governance. Ties among European states were becoming closer. Consequently, when times started getting worse, nation states began to resent European ties, contesting the unwillingness of European institutions to recognize enough their specific national characters. A parallel situation was experienced by national churches. Their situation, in fact, has become over time a little schizophrenic. On one hand, to conform to European standards, traditional churches had accepted the privatization of religious belonging, left to the free conscience of individuals. On the other, the same traditional churches had kept their previous public status within the single European countries, confirming their special identification with nation-state identities. So, like nation-states, national churches start showing a certain uneasiness toward these changes. Their disappointment, in fact, has been to be faced with secularization and empty churches in exchange for their opening to human rights and individual freedom. It has been difficult for them to develop a theology of secularization. Consequently, after 1989, with the end of the Cold War and the simultaneous highly symbolic celebration of the bicentenary of the French Revolution, pluralism, secularization, and Muslim immigration suddenly appear in a new light. The lack of a real shared universal and plural European narrative became evident. It is in 1989, in fact, that the headscarf starts being seen as an ostentatious religious symbol. The once glorified discourses about universality, human rights, and pluralism start spinning around, being perceived as cold and technocratic discourses against people's feelings. European nation states and national religions experience a similar discomfort faced with globalization and start dreaming of the former status quo. In this new situation, a combined reference to national and traditional religions and nation states' history and culture has become the heart of the critique of the pluralistic and universalistic approach. The perception and depiction of European minorities change dramatically. They were former colonial subjects in the early 50s, people of a different color in the 50s and 60s, of a different race in the 60s and 80s, of a different culture in the 90s, but from the 2000s, they became people of different faith and religion. Moreover, while in the past an immigrant was a person with foreigner citizenship in search of work, in the 2000s, immigrant took a much stronger cultural connotation, one perceived as not sharing traditional European values and religions. And this even though most European Muslims are native European citizens, the so-called second generations, and when in various countries Muslim European citizens sit in parliaments or in other political representative bodies. From temporary immigrants, perceived in the one-dimensional perspective of the labor market, Muslims became permanent residents and citizens perceived in a one-dimensional religious perspective. Once the labor market started showing the first sign of crisis and internal conflict, signal structural problems, Europe found that the newcomers had still not gone away. On the contrary, they were beginning to express their views on how to rearrange the common house according also to their needs. The first reaction to this situation has been the raising of barriers to enter Europe, asking for specific linguistic and civic tests or selecting immigrants through agreements only with some specific countries. After September 11 and July 7, when British Muslims attacked the London Tube, Islam began to symbolize the limits of the European tolerance, the limit of what multiculturalist policies could accept. All political parties born from the 70s, for example the French National Front, to the 90s, the British UKIP, on the wave of neo-nationalism and anti-EU rhetoric, the UKIP was exactly born after the 1992 Maastricht Treaty, immediately identified Islam a good brand to exploit. The new right-wing and chauvinist parties and movements that have grown up everywhere in Europe, especially in Italy, Austria, Netherlands, and Scandinavian countries, between the 90s and the new century, show well this dynamic. Consequently, more traditional European political parties also have started speaking about the end of multiculturalism and the danger of Islam to contain this extreme right-wing pressure. As David Cameron declared with the full consent of the German Chancellor Angela Merkel in a speech in Berlin in February 2011, I quote, the roots of the problem of terrorism were first, I quote, Islamist extremism, and secondly, I quote again, the doctrine of state multiculturalism, which encouraged different cultures to live separate lives, apart from each other and the mainstream, and which weakened our collective identity. It is true that David Cameron carefully distinguished between Islamist extremism and Islam, but once you have identified something connected to Islam as the root of the problem, Cameron's distinction between Muslims and Islamist extremism was perceived by the public as a merely incidental detail. This new narrative can be very dangerous. Only a few months after Cameron's speech in July 2011, a 22-year-old Norwegian, Anders Breivik, in a ranting hate against Muslims' invasion and multiculturalism, killed 70 young people between 14 and 20 years in the highland of Utøya during a summer camp of the Young Workers League. Why is this anti-Islamic narrative so strong? On one side, the contemporary anti-Islamic narrative is rooted in the old European colonial orientalism and reactivates the classic colonial misrepresentation a la Renant, for which, I quote, Islam is the most complete negation of Europe. On the other, this reification of Islam and Europe also mobilizes those who perceive immigrants as dangerous and entitled to increasingly scarce welfare resources. In fact, if on one side the economic crisis has allowed Muslim women to enter the job market, encouraging integration and changes, on the other, this presence of women in the labor market, often accompanied by headscarf and other non-mainstream garments, makes the Muslim presence more visible. An essentialized Sharia starts symbolizing Europe's enemy par excellence. In a decision of February 2003, the European Court of Human Rights declared, I quote, Sharia incompatible with the fundamental principle of democracy as set forth in the Convention, particularly with regard to the way it intervenes in all spheres of private and public life in accordance with religious precepts. The Strasbourg Court depicted Sharia as stable and invariable, and a source of law where principles such as pluralism in the political sphere or the constant evolution of public freedoms have no place. End of the quotation. According to the court, in fact, Sharia would, I quote, oblige individuals to obey not rules laid down by the state, but static rules of law imposed by the religion concerned. Such a representation of the main Islamic source leads to the perception that Muslims are impossible European citizens, with doubtful loyalty to European state-nation institutions. Beginning in the second half of the 90s, the German concept of Leitkultur, interpreted by the mainstream as an autochthonous cultural citizenship, and so as a concept that excluded any Muslim European citizenship, started being quite influential. A consequence of these changes has been the idealization of a utopian time of European social cohesion, dated in an apparent age without immigrants and above all without Muslims. The need to restore this social cohesion has served as the rationale of the French and Belgian legal ban of the Burg, validated in July this year by the Strasbourg Court. The essentialization of Islam, in fact, is reflected in the essentialization of Muslims. The good individual freedom of choice of native European citizens has become a centripetal menace when experienced by non-traditional believers, and namely Muslims, pictured as members of an antagonistic, particularly pervasive and cohesive nomos group. The case of the headscarf has been, in this sense, particularly illustrative. As in the case of Sharia, also in this case, the Strasbourg court didn't hesitate to broadcast its own authentic theological interpretation. In fact, for the Strasbourg court, I quote, wearing of a headscarf appears to be imposed on a woman by a precept which is laid down in the Quran, and which is hard to square with the principle of gender equality. Again, for the court, I quote, it therefore appears difficult to reconcile the wearing of an Islamic headscarf with a message of tolerance, respect for others, and above all, equality and non-discrimination, typical of democratic society. End of the quotation. This legal approach ignores how wedding in Europe is often a political statement of women, an active reappropriation on their behalf of Islamic religiosity and way of life, rather than its reproduction by established traditions. For this reason, the approach of the Strasbourg Court risks reproducing in the contemporary time what Leila Hamed has called colonial feminism, namely a feminism as used against other cultures in the service of colonialism, or today in the service of the marginalization of Muslims. The European shift from a pluralist to a culturalist and anti-Islamic public narrative highlights a tension present among all social actors in Europe today. This tension is particularly clear when we look at nation-state policies, traditional national churches, and Muslims themselves. Regarding the nation-state's policies, we have seen that as soon as the Muslim presence became more visible, the shift from an accommodationist and pragmatic attitude toward a deep ideological resistance to cultural and religious differences has become evident. Pragmatic and accommodationist attitude have operated more easily at the local level. In fact, the more sensitive issues concerning Muslims, such as religious and cultural associations, places of worship and cemeteries, ritual slaughtering, circumcisions, and health issues, are addressed first of all by local authorities. At the same time, this local level is also the place where the anti-pluralistic narrative takes place. So on the one hand, cities and regional administrations, even when administrated by culturalist and chauvinist political movements, are often where parties are forced to find open or hidden arrangements in order to ensure some degree of social cohesion. On the other, the same local level is the place where essentialist ideas are nourished and widespread to at the national level, because of the fact that it is at this local level that these same chauvinistic parties can more easily find support. At the national level, the weight of ideological discourse is heavier. It can be translated into illiberal laws, Banovescan and Burka, draconian measures against Muslim association and places of worship, or into a sort of laziness in implementing multicultural policies in school, healthcare system, and public services. But it is at this national level that abstract discourses about Islam adapt to the right to religious freedom, producing a perception of Muslims as a compact community incapable of creating its own church. European states, in their paternalistic role, try to force Muslims to organize themselves as a structured and a hierarchical church, obliging Muslims to enter into competition with each other in order to assign political authority the selection of the unique representative of the Islamic denomination. This forced projection onto Islam of the monistic feature of Christianity illustrates the limit of European state neutrality. In fact, the organization of Muslims as a centralized religion is directly connected with the political debate about values and depend on the state's discretionary power in selecting the more moderate Muslim representation, namely the best connected for different political reasons with central state authorities. Nevertheless, this method is not working. In fact, in most European countries, unified organization of Muslims either does not exist or malfunctions with acute internal struggle due to lack of transparency and inefficiency. This is, for example, the case in Spain, where the Concordat signed in 1992 between the state and a Muslim federation is unable to ensure Islamic education in state schools because of internal Muslim divisions regarding the choice of teachers. It is also the case in Germany, where the only Muslim association elevated by the state to the rank of public corporation is not recognized by the other groups, which will contest its heterodox character. Many difficulties with this model also have been experienced in Belgium, where Islam has been since 1974 a recognized cult, but in which the state has continuously intervened in the internal life of the various communities. Recently, tension and difficulties have also emerged in Austria, where the recognition of Islam dates back to imperial times. Newly proposed revisions would, among other changes, regulate the training and hiring of Muslim clerics, prohibit the foreign founding of mosques and the support by Austrian Muslim associations of organizations outside the country, and establish an official German language version of the Quran, with the goal of preventing its misinterpretation by extremists. This forced organization, this confessionalization from above, on the basis of the hierarchical church model, has high costs. The will to build a national Muslim church empowers monistic groups against plural individuals and centralizes local associations. This causes both the legitimation of religious hierarchies that condition the life of local associations and paradoxically accentuates the process of communalization of Muslim identities. Moreover, the search by European nation states for a moderate Islam often coincides with stronger politically oriented ties between these European states and their Muslim majority state counterpart, considered by the former more reliable than European Muslim citizens. Last October, a Muslim British member of the European Parliament called the Grand Mufti of Egypt to speak about true and namely moderate Islam in Britain, implying that local Muslims are failing in transmitting moderate, namely state Islam. So far from bringing European Muslims into European institutions, the process of confessionalization has become an opportunity for foreign countries to strengthen their control over what continues to be, in their view, a national diaspora. The dependence of the fortunes of European Muslims on the relationship between European and Muslim majority states has been particularly evident in the Arab Spring. The success of Muslim Brothers in Egypt helped European Muslim movements close to the Brotherhood to be acknowledged by European state authorities. On the contrary, the fall of President Morsi has marked a negative change for these same European associations. Like nation states, also traditional European churches are fully involved in this debate. The change in the religious European landscape and the use of religious references by anti-pluralistic forces requires traditional European religions to take a position. In particular, the image of Islam as a religion able to move in society without the constraints of the politically correctness typical of national religions and apparently able to keep strong ties among its faithful, elicits in traditional churches a strong longing for a similar freedom, for the religious freedom before it became a right to religious freedom controlled by the state. This feeling influences two very different positions within traditional European religions, one more and one much less sympathetic to Muslims. The first leads to a stronger universalism and so a freer presence of traditional churches in the public sphere. In this case, national religious institutions, as part of transnational religious realities of world religions, differentiate their faith from national states that need to keep precise territorial boundaries. This differentiation can take, for example, the form of support for supplementary jurisdictions that reflect the personal and not the territorial nature of religious laws. This was the case of a notorious speech of the former Archbishop of Canterbury, Rowan Williams, in which the spiritual head of the Anglican Church praised the possibility of limited recognition by state legal systems of private accommodations, reached on the basis of arbitration grounded on religious laws. But this universalist approach poses serious problems. It is in fact difficult for traditional churches to be both in the opposition and in the government, both free in the public arena and recognized by nation states as public national churches. The second position, on the contrary, takes the form of a strong fight against relativism and secularization, perceived as the bitter fruit of the universalist and multiculturalist approach. In this perspective, the legal status of traditional churches becomes a starting point for a bigger institutional influence aimed at carving in the name of national and traditional religious values what are described as the perverse effect of cultural and religious pluralism. It's worth noting that in this fight against pluralism, traditional churches are also supported by many non-believers, called in Italy, for example, devout atheists, who use or manipulate traditional religious discourses in an anti-Muslim fashion. But this more culturalist approach also poses problems. In fact, it is difficult for traditional churches to be at the same time state churches and really consequential with their contemporary theologies. The same attitude toward pluralism and monism already described within nation states and national churches also exists among Muslims. On one side, reflecting the essentialist European image of Islam, some Muslims interpret the demand for organization and institutionalization coming from Europe and at the same time the fear of an essentialized Sharia as an opportunity to refuse internal pluralism and to establish on the continent a sort of Orientalist Islam. Sharia entrepreneurs nurture their personal and clan power through public discourses that reflect those of their strongest opponents, with a combined and tragic segregating effect. Rejecting a forced choice between an essentialist Israelitic Islam and a European version of a state-controlled moderate Islam, other European Muslims have tried to rediscover a Sharia made it methodologically closer to the classical one, namely a non-binding and non-state Sharia administrated by private skilled scholars in the service of pre-private demands. This is the Sharia described, for example, very well known by Tariq Ramadan, but is also that of the French Imam Tarek Oubrou, engaged in the construction of an authentic European faith. I would define Tariq Ramadan as a representative of a suffering Islam, an Islam that cannot forget the colonial past and for which the recognition by European states is the necessary and due compensation for the iniquities of the past. The claim approach and a persistent moral disdain is characteristic in his approach. Differently, Oubrou represents an Islam less influenced by this past and fully engaged in the optic of the supplementary jurisdictions discussed by Rowan Williams, showing the availability also for Islam of the so-called transformative accommodations, where all parties may be changed by their encounter over time, avoiding the sterility of mutually exclusive monopolies. Most of the so-called second generation and European converts to Islam are moving into these last two positions, playing the role of bridges in the relationships between Muslim associations and public authorities, and in the process of transformative accommodations of religious practices. Some short conclusions. Muslims are a permanent European reality, and both they and European states should focus on this reality and not look abroad at foreign states to solve their problems. This attitude can generate dangerous illusions. Transformative accommodations are necessary for Europeans of all backgrounds facing the challenges of diversity today. As history teaches, neither religious practices nor nation-state tradition are unchangeable. In this sense, multiculturalism not only is not ended, but multicultural policies are the only one that can produce social cohesion in public order. These latter, in fact, are the product of the concrete enjoyment of constitutional rights and not of their discriminatory violation. The recent media coverage of the European fighters of the ISIS caliphate cannot be the pretext to reiterate anachronistic closures, but on the contrary, to be more effective in the implementation of a real policy of integration. Political parties should concern themselves with a more integrated and not fragmented view of the economic crisis, citizenship, cultural and religious diversity. In this regard, national guidelines for local policies will be very welcome and useful and important, as well as a greater cooperation between public actors involved in the process of integration, local powers, universities, public bodies, associations in the civil society. The right to religious freedom must cease to play a regressive role. It should be enforced in its personal, individual dimension, lightening its institutional part, making this latter more connected with civil society than with institutional space, In other words, more associations, fewer churches. At the same time, Muslim leaderships should avoid seeking advantage in the ambiguities of the political powers. An open debate within communities between old and unchangeable leadership and a younger generation, as well as one about the training of imams and other scholars able to work in the European context, need to happen. To be optimistic today, because yesterday someone told me that I'm very pessimistic, so I make some effort. To be optimistic today, I would like to emphasize three new trends present within each of the three societal actors I've just spoken about, the state, the traditional church, and the Muslim. First of all, this year, for the first time, we have witnessed a change in the Strasbourg court narrative about Islam. Although the court has validated the French ban of the burqa in July, it has nevertheless explicitly refused to validate the classic Orientalist mantra about women, headscarf, and violation of human rights. Secondly, at the level of traditional churches, the election of Pope Francis has changed the perception, if not the substance, of the relationship between an important mainstream religion and Muslim. If Pope Benedict's Regnibus talk was essential in spreading the idea of an Islamic irrationality, the present Pope has changed the perception of the approach to Islam, refusing to follow common stereotypes, underlining his letter, Evangelii Gaudium, the respect of the Catholic Church for Islam as a religion. For the people Pope, Islam was more a culture, not a religion. Third, at the level of Muslim communities, the role of young Muslims were establishing new relationships with the old European society. I hope that from this innovation, a new institutional narrative could begin. Thank you.
Questions?
How do you see these forces for multiculturalism playing out in the education systems of the different European societies in terms of trying to reconcile these different forces?
You know, education European systems are very different, so It's difficult to speak about an European background. But we can distinguish it maybe between three ideal types, the British, the French, and the continent not French. So I would say in Europe, in England, you know, in UK, multicultural policies in education, also about Islam, are very well grounded. And above all, the curriculum, for example, for the religious teaching is co-shared by different religious people and the civil at the civil level. And I think in this case, I think that is a very, very good model. And we have already, in, for example, in the topic of the civic education, a lot of instruments that are the product not only from the government, but also from Muslims community themselves. Though there is a sort of good relationships, I think, between public powers and Islamic communities. The problem in Britain is maybe connected, and this is a paradox, with the public schools, so the private schools, because what is a sort of paradox that when the cool British multiculturalism was in crisis, was the same moment when Blair started a policy favorishing the private Muslim school also. So we have had this kind of public discourse, again, multiculturalism, in the same time, a sort of encouragement of private schools. And now, just in these days, some school had a sort of inspection, and things apparently are not good, but also there is a sort of coverage by media that is not fair, I think, about this situation. But the British model, you know, is a sort of, I would say, education from religion, so a sort of good feeling about religion and also what religion can do to the system. If we go to the French system, the idea of citizenship is quite different, and so religion is not present in school, the headscarf is not present in school, but at the same time, France has tried to integrate this kind of religious skills in the ordinary education. So they have program about religion and civic education administered directly by the state. We have a report, the report that has been made in 2002 by Régis Desprez, is a report about religious education in France, that, and also the idea of secularism as mood. But the problem in France is this strong conflict between a narrative and a sort of narrative secularism and the legal secularism. If we just have a look to constitutional background of France, secularism is perfectly fine, pluralist, and has a very strong pluralistic root. But the Third Republic, I would say, narrative of secularism as anti-clerical and a sort of compt vision of positivism and scientism against religion can be a limit for integrating the religious discourse in public education. Germany, Italy, Spain, this kind of country, are a mix between a sort of education into religion, so where also religion have a role, a public role within public school, state school, to implement their own curricula. And the situation is, I would say, less dialectic than in other parts of Europe. In Germany, we have in some Länder the possibility to teach Islamic education. Some Länder have had some problem in relation to the headscarf worn by teachers, not by students, but worn by teacher. In Italy, we have not this kind of problem because we are not, like France, a state nation. We are a nation state, so the idea of citizenship is quite different than France, and so religious is very part of the public dimension, and so thanks to this Catholic presence, also Muslim presence can be accepted in the public sphere in some way, and so also in school. So school is both in two directions important, for pupils that attend to school and from the teacher. The problem is the curricula, who teach Islam to teachers. So we have not in many European countries a place where to be divinity schools or religious studies are not so organized as here or in England, in continental Europe. We have cases of faculty of theology, for example, and in Germany and in Strasbourg, where the Concordat is not applied, they try to form also to this kind of Islamic religion, but the problem is with the sides. What Islam is, and the state interprets this role of training teacher in Islam sometimes more in a security term than in a pedagogical one. So it's always not so neutral and clear what is the situation. I don't know if this was the
thing. Do you want to extend that to an American educational system?
No, it's for you the question.
Yes, in the back there?
I was in
the back. Sorry.
Towards the end, you...
Can you stand up? Because we can't hear you.
I can shout.
For me, it's fine.
Oh, I'm
towards the end, you mentioned this idea that Muslims is a permanent feature of Europe, and therefore, as I understood you say, that Europe needs to look inside itself for models rather than outside. I take it you meant to the broader Muslim world. I was wondering, that put me in mind of sort of the opposite of that plausible equation, which is how, because one can often observe, I think both regarding European Muslim populations and North American, their deployment as models for organization and behavior of the rest of the Islamic world. And I'm wondering if you have any comments on whether or not, to what degree European or North American Muslim populations are or are not plausible model for the rest of the world.
Yeah. In general, I'm very suspicious about model, this kind of, you know. So, letting apart the fact of my own suspicion about models, but the question is interesting. American Muslims and European Muslims, I guess, that have quite different histories in terms of background, in terms of integration, in terms of timing when arrive, in terms of size, because you know, just in Germany, in France, there are between 6 and 7 million. Only in France, in Germany, there are more Muslim in Germany than in Lebanon. So Europe has a quite huge number of Muslims, very different. But it's interesting your question because, in fact, is. We in Europe we think about it because you know we think Muslims arrive in Europe, they are enjoying more what we think religious freedom in Europe done in their countries. They're experiencing really the ummah, because you know, in some villages there are just, or city, there are just one mosque, and so Arabic speaker, not Arabic, Shiite and Sunni sometime have to go together, and so some ethnical divisions and not boundaries are not easily kept. And so they are experiencing a sort of what is called fiqh of minorities, so they have to, and so the thinking is, are they experiencing a liberal citizenship? Are they coping with secularism, with some idea that can go also to the southern shore? So far, this is not really proved. In the sense that what is interesting is that Imam from the south that arrive to Europe, not European imam, that go to the south to teach. So the idea that they are still a diaspora, in theological terms, is still strong. So I think that this is one of the bigger tensions between young generation that they feel to be European and old generation. Younger Muslims accept with less enthusiasm to be preached by an imam that doesn't speak Italian, doesn't speak German, doesn't speak English. And so in this case, we assist to a sort of personal rediscovering of the Islamic traditions, but really in an individual way, sometimes not reorganized. And there are studies, you know, there is in Ireland a council about European fatwas that was one of the prominent, was a Karadawi, very famous, not exactly a European imam. So, you know, Karadawi is working very well, so his the fatwas try to cope with European system. So they represent a sort of, but I don't know, is something that, and I don't think that there will be a European model, and you know, in the globalization is enough to send a mail that they go very quickly to go on the website. So I think that the movement is really a movement that concerns simultaneously the two shores of the Mediterranean, because so is more a sort of movement that is transversal to generation, to intellectuals, to, so I would say that we are speaking about a Mediterranean Islam again, so a sort that common process, I would hope. So.
Yes.
I have several observations or questions. First of all, I would like to refer to your first issue, namely Islam-Europe relationship within a wider context. It's more than 14 or 1500 years. It has been in constant tension. As a matter of fact, an American historian appeared before a committee and claimed, and I'm quoting, that the longest war, Cold War, has been between Islam and Europe. You have constant tension, attempt to reconciliate, and then more recently, during the past two centuries, you have the advent of colonialism. Colonialism invaded most Muslim countries. Naturally, it has created another issue which added the tension between both. Within Europe, Islam did not disappear. You have it in part of Turkey, and you have it in Yugoslavia and Albania. I am wondering whether these indigenous European Muslims played any role to improve the perception or the understanding.
Yeah.
And the waves of immigrations, we have it in America as well. You mentioned workers, but that was the first wave. After that, you have waves of professionals, yeah, intellectuals, writers, poets, artists, and so forth, thousands of them. Scholars like Tariq Ramadan, a great scholar who has a better chance to act as a bridge. My question is all of these. How do you address? And secondly, European Muslim scholars, have they played any role in this process? I'm sorry, I am raising.
No.
Let me add, I used to teach, by the way, 20 years ago, the subject of Western view of Islam, and I used 7 book. If you remember, his important classic book, Western Views of Islam in the Middle Ages. Have we added to what Seven has done? I mean, do we improve this Western view?
Yeah.
Or we have the same issues there?
You know, I follow the order of your statement. 200 years of Cold War? No, I think that maybe we have had 200 years or even more of wars and Cold Wars, but I don't think that this period was just Islam against Europe. You know, this kind of wars, many Europeans were with Turks against other Europeans. It was much more mixed, you know, was commercial interest. So France was very happy when Turks were against the Venetians or other countries. So it was not a real, Cold War in ideological terms. It was used, but nations, European states, has used or had coped with Ottoman neighbors in many different ways. So what I think is heavier is the colonial heritage. Here we are really in a bad situation. And in fact, when I quote Ernest, because it was not only a colonialism that affected power relationships or the occupation of the land, was a colonialism of the spirit. Was a colonialism that had a very bad influence in the perception of the Islamic sources. The idea of Sharia as a positivistic law, the idea of codification of Sharia, the idea that Sharia is a precept, is very connected to this idea that also had a very bottom-up origin when start really in Indonesia, but also when applied in the Mediterranean, when to administrate some land of this barbarian Muslim was necessary to codify their role, to write, to know what is the law that they use. So this role has been very, very dangerous and still today, still present. So this is a very hard heritage. And we risk also reproducing. It's very difficult to eradicate this kind of spiritual colonialism and this kind of perception. Balkans Muslims are very interesting realities. But the Cold War, on one side, has kept them quite apart from the debate that has been developed, in the western side of Europe, where the immigrants and also intellectuals after they arrived. And now, in these kind of countries, we assist a sort of strange situation. In some ways, the opposite, the situation of Balkan Islam of what is in the western part. Because it's in the west, in the Eastern part, we have old generation of Muslims that are kept maybe some sort of like the Uniat Church or the Christians in some communist countries. So this kind of religious roots, but a complete young generation that is completely that has not this kind of roots. For them, new Balkans Muslims are not connected to their past, are that just new Muslims are the Western one. And in these Balkans territories, we assist a sort of strong presence of Saudi Arabia, Qatar, this kind of help that came from abroad. And this has, in this part of the world, play a big role. Individuals, intellectuals, I hope sometimes they are also workers, in the sense that sometimes they work too, like other people. but they are perceived more, I think, as individuals. And so their role, for example, the artists that arrive, you know, when, this is interesting also, the person of success is not Muslim anymore, is the artist. The worker that has not success remain Muslim. So in some way, use religious affiliations is depends on your economic success. Can be the first identity, or can be something that can be also very nice, because you can call about Andalusia, this kind of thing. And intellectual, like Ramadan, of course, they have played an important role. I think that sometime, maybe they play a sort of real individual also role, in the sense that is also a problem and a question to enlarge the vision to what happens in the real, not the real, they are also real, but in the daily mosque's life. This is also very important. So I think that more than this kind of intellectual that are important, but we need to overcome this sort of charismatic intellectual Muslim presence in Europe, to go to another step where this kind of intellectual can be more widespread, can be more common to have skilled Muslims. So I think that, I hope that we can go toward a situation where it could be more usual to have intellectual Muslims, not just some stars, you know, that, and they also can be, have, you know, ambiguous influences in mosque. So I think that Muslims have to be reassured by themselves that they can be good intellectual, not can be fine to be connected to some single people, but you know, we need a more general development. And I think the young generation will do that.
Yes.
So
I
have a with the rise of feminist Muslims who see Islam oftentimes as a something that can be seen through more of a modern lens or a lens of, I guess, Western human rights ideology, do you think this group of seeing Islam as that increases their chances of being integrated within Europe, or ostracizes the more traditional Muslims more?
You know, also in this case, we have so many different kind of feminisms, and I can say that we can have three main trends. I will summarize. One is maybe represented by women that want to justify their Islamic identity using Western style, not in terms of clothes, but of thinking. So we have had some Muslim women very influential that has written books against the headscarf, against like sign of backwardness, or sign of, and this was very welcomed by the mainstream. But I don't know if this helps their own integration, because you know, in this case, they are integrated as far as they continue this kind of critique of their own identity, this kind of reading that is literature. Then there is another, I think, important part in young generation, where I think this question is coped with much more, I would say, natural attitude. So I think the discussion about the role of the woman in the job market, the labor market, about clothes, is among young generation is very common. Is also commonly connected to a sort of debate about Quran, Sharaitic sources. And then there is, among this group of young people that debate and make different choices, a group that use more religious identity as a sign to be more present in public society. So is what happens also in majoritarian Muslim state, where to wear a chador in Iran is not to be isolated in the private sphere, but to go to university, to be very skilled. And so in Europe, maybe this kind of choice is to be identified as a Muslim, because in an identity that you are proud to have, and you want to be identified with this kind of identity, to play a political role, a political in a broad sense. And so, you know, we can see that here we have two public ways to have a Muslim identity, one against this kind of women's image, one in favor, but in the public debate, and one more private, and in this private, or I would say more, not institutional public sphere, but public sphere of civil society, where you can have both of these and many other choices together. So I would say two extreme and one middle that we can find overlapping between these situations.
I have a question.
Well.
One question. So you described a shift in Europe from a cool multiculturalism and maybe a cold religious identity in the 90s to a hot religious identity, where religion matters more and it's a stronger sense of identity and has a stronger presence, that the Roy Jenkins version of multiculturalism, religion and culture, they should all be respected, and we should have a kind of plural public space, but suddenly it's all about religion. Do you think we need to go back to a cooler mode?
You know, it's a voluntaristic answer you want from me.
No, I don't know.
I think that how I said at the end, the right to religious freedom as it's organized now is a problem, I think, but it's very difficult to change because as constitutional roots that nobody is able to change it. Hot religiosity is the product of the secularization, so I think this hot religiosity is really interesting because the hot religiosity is the hot religiosity of people that is not personal religious. So is an extreme of the secularization. So I don't know if it will be possible to come back in another age. I think what I hope, I prefer between the two, the first model. So the Roy Jenkins model, to be honest.
So the right to religious freedom, though, produced the hot religiosity. So if we want to go back to the cool religiosity, we have to go back before the right.
No, but you know, what you said, the right to religious freedom was still there also at the time of the cool religiosity. Because in a strictly legal term, the right to religious freedom, you know, the laws about religious freedom are very few. So the problem is not the right to religious freedom, is its symbolic role in the national building, in the nation state building. So the right to religious freedom is not about articles, but is really about constitution, about the general spirit. So what I think is that, you know, it's a matter of interpretation, more of change. So,
okay. Any other questions? So please join me in thank. There's a reception outside. Please stay, and you can talk to our speaker.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.